There's a special little dance I have to do between the coffee maker and my desk, just to prevent my hot coffee from spilling over the edge of the mug. Maybe you're familiar with it. The key is to walk smoothly, but not too fast, and also for some reason, not too slow. In the end, I often just give up and drink my coffee standing in the middle of the hallway. Because no matter what I try, the coffee is determined to slosh. And this doesn't happen to a lot of the other beverages I carry. So what's going on? Turns out, it's because of physics. Physicists love coffee, and they love studying everyday problems, which means they've dedicated several peer-reviewed papers to the factors that jostle your Joe. And it all comes down to an unlucky connection between your pace, the cup, and that tasty morning brew. Beverages slosh when you walk because of a thing called resonance. Think about sitting on a playground swing. When you pump your legs, or if someone pushes you with perfect timing, then you'll swing higher and higher. The cadence of that just right timing is called a resonant frequency. In the case of the swing, it's determined by the length of the chains. Any system that oscillates has these special frequencies that can lead to resonance. So if you add external force to the system, and if it's timed to match the resonant frequency, then the amplitude of the oscillations can become enormous. Did anyone else's parents ever push them to scary heights on the swing? The story isn't much different for liquids sloshing around in a container. The resonant frequency of a liquid depends on its density and the shape of the container. There's a fancy formula that accounts for all the details, and if you plug in a few variables, including the density of coffee and the size of an average mug, you'll find that the lowest resonant frequency of the mug is between 1 to 2.5 oscillations per second. You can try this for yourself. Get a mug full of coffee and watch what happens as you walk. It might swish a little left and right as you switch weight between your legs, but most of the sloshing is going to be forward and backward, in line with the direction you're walking, and with a frequency of about 1 to 2.5 sloshes per second. Eventually, these tiny motions add together and end up making you spill, because every time you take a step, you add a force in the direction of your motion. And here's that unlucky connection to your cup that I mentioned. The average frequency of a person walking is typically about 1 to 2.5 steps per second. That's the exact resonant frequency of a typical coffee mug. Those small forces at just the right time intervals make the waves in the mug get taller and taller until you got a big stain on your khakis. Or in my case, my lab coat. There are a couple tricks you could use to make the ride smoother for your mug, and they all depend on disrupting that perfect timing between your gait and the mug's resonant frequency. First, you can hold the rim of the mug in a claw-like grip. This alters how your body transfers force to the mug as you step forward. The net effect is that you're less likely to hit resonance. But this grip introduces the risk of burning your hand, plus you get finger grime all over the rim. So another study suggests putting your coffee mug in a little pouch, suspended by long strings. As you walk, the pouch will swing at a very different frequency than the resonant frequency of the mug. So I guess you could crochet a coffee mug sling, like, oh, let me just take a little sip of coffee from my coffee purse. Or, my personal favorite, studies suggest you could just walk backward, which slows you down and makes your pace irregular because it's weird. An irregular pace means that you can't jostle your mug at regular intervals, which means no wave resonance. But there are some obvious problems with these solutions. So let's talk about some more realistic ways we could prevent the sear of the slosh. Before we get into those solutions, a quick ad.
Thank you for watching SciShow. To keep videos like this free for everyone forever, you can join us in the second annual Complexly Learnathon. Learnathon is a celebration of learning, of our free content here at SciShow and all of Complexly. We've got new fun merch this month, like SciShow Dice, behind-the-scenes videos, and more, plus a donor-exclusive Discord where you can play games and participate in learning challenges with other Complexly viewers. Go to complexlylearnathon.com to check out the Learnathon schedule and support our cool stuff.
First, you could change your coffee order. A layer of foam on top of a beverage efficiently dissipates a lot of sloshing energy, preventing large waves from building up and eventually tipping over the edge. That's why a pint of beer is far less likely to slosh than a pint of cold brew coffee. So consider swapping your drip coffee for a cappuccino, if you have a swanky office coffee bar. Or here's an idea. We could just stop making mugs shaped in the exact way that causes resonance when we walk. Wine glasses and brandy snifters curve inward at the top, and the change in shape helps damp the oscillations that make us spill from a cylindrical mug. The inward curve actually shifts the entire shape of the oscillating wave so that even the tallest sloshes are unlikely to spill out. Mugs with a wide base and a narrow mouth could solve these transportation issues. So why haven't we done it yet? I guess cylindrical mugs are easy to clean and drink from, and they're probably the easiest shape to manufacture. Pros and cons. But researchers suggest the best solution might just be paying attention. Now, I was a barista for many years, and I was specifically told not to pay attention to the coffee mugs I carried. My trainers told me that paying too much attention makes you overcorrect and ultimately spill more. Reddit is also full of tips for servers to not look at the trays of drinks they carry. But one paper found that focusing on carrying a mug can substantially reduce the risk of coffee spillage. They found the focus subjects had smaller accelerations. Basically, the coffee surface was still pretty smooth by the time the subjects got up to normal walking speed, aka the mug's resonant frequency speed. Smoother coffee equals fewer waves that can get amplified at resonance, so focused subjects were able to take more steps before their coffee spilled. But that's one paper against an entire service industry's worth of advice. I think we might need some more studies on this particular point. I know this all may seem trivial, but these lessons do have some broader applications, specifically for robotics. Motions like carrying a cup of coffee require a lot of fine motor control. You, a human, can sense and respond to subtle shifts in the motion of a complex or chaotic system. With practice and focus, humans can balance weird-shaped objects or carry mugs with chaotically sloshing liquid. And there are many similarly complex tasks that we'd eventually like to teach robots how to do. So researchers are studying how humans carry cups of coffee, trying to quantify their strategies for predicting and controlling the system. They're applying these lessons to the ways that robots adapt their motor control in response to sensory feedback. So if you start seeing headlines about coffee-carrying robots, you'll know why. In the end, the best way to not spill your coffee seems to be to take it easy. Maybe sip your mug next to the coffee maker while you gab with your coworkers about this video. Or switch up your mug carrying grip to avoid exciting the walking pace resonance frequency. Gosh, can you imagine a SciShow brand coffee sling? As for me, I'll be checking out my local craft markets for some unorthodox mug shapes. I'll let you know if I find a good one.